And welcome everybody to a GT3 street fight between four leagues, 48 drivers, one champion, Broken Wing Racing League, Can-Am Sim Sport, Osborne Motorsport Endurance Challenge, otherwise known as OMEC, and West Coast Racing. We're going to be starting qualifying in 12 minutes here in the booth with me. I've got Noah Hodgkinson representing Broken Wing Racing League, as well as Sean McStay for the West Coast Racing. Welcome, you guys.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, hey, happy to be here.
And for anyone in the chat, if any of the commentators are a little low on this volume, just let us know, and I'll adjust it. So far, we have almost every single driver is in, and up to 38 drivers have set a lap. A couple drivers out of those that haven't, the remaining are. I think there's two in the pits, and the rest are trying to set some times on the board. Yeah, and as it stands, looking at the gaps there on the side, it looks like Curtis Jones of West Coast Racing, as well as Chris Brunemmer and P2 with Trey Misak in three. So three in a row for Broken Ring Racing League, as well as why looks like Cass and Omek are rounding it out there with the 8 and 9 spot. For those watching in this just practice right now, Sean, can you take us into some insight on those two drivers that are topping the boards right there in one and two?
Yeah, for sure. So, I mean, Curtis has been racing with WCR for a long time. He's a great driver, really clean racer, really very specific with how he drives his car. Not a lot of stuff happens with that car that he doesn't need for it to happen. So, I'm excited to see him doing well here at Road America. Chris, as well, is he's a thoughtful driver. Both really experienced guys. We've got a few more that I think they're higher down the list. The best times in yet, but definitely excited to
And with that said, we got Cody Johnson also hitting that fastest lap. Noah, Trey and Jeff Jacob as well, and Chris Schitterling. What can you say about them right now? They're sitting there in the kind of in the middle spot there in the top 10.
We actually just saw Cody Johnson jump up into P1 at the moment too. But yeah, generally Trey is kind of our front runner, has been for the last couple seasons. He's been just consistently quick. Schitterling is usually one of the guys that's right on his tail, usually able to give him some pretty good competition in GT3 and in our Super Formula Light series. But yeah, I mean Chris, Trey, Jeff, Jacob, they're all super talented drivers, so I wouldn't be surprised to see all of them up in the top 10 and fighting for the front five positions.
Yeah, and with that said, we'll take a look over here at Scott Kimbrough, who's the only driver in the OMEC in the top 10, as well as Brandon Fick, that 8 and 9 spot for these two drivers representing their leagues. We don't have representatives for them to talk on their behalf, but I mean, really sporting some really strong laps. The last lap for Scott was a little bit slower than his best lap, but same with Brandon Fick. His last lap was actually nowhere near his 204 that he did, but only three drivers are in the 203s. That's gonna be hard to get in there, and all three of them are West Coast Racing. That's gotta feel good, right, Sean?
Yeah, no, the guys have been putting a lot of work together, practice sessions, time tuning setups, doing all that type of stuff to put their best foot forward for this race. And they're excited about their prizes, but they're also, I think, excited to try and keep the WCR name as close to the top as we can be, certainly.
Yeah, as we look up and down, we have 40 drivers who have set times on the board. There's four drivers that are in the pit lane who have not set a time on the board. So John Jovecki, Eric Koonsman of Broken Ring Racing League, and Jordan Smith of West Coast Racing, kind of curious to see what they're going to set. Elliot Burton, one of our fast drivers in this league, has not set a time on the board, and as I no, he's still he's out there, but nothing from him just yet. John Jovecki, another strong contender, as well as Eric Koonsman. Still nothing out of them.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see. Obviously, you know, this is practice, but it'll be interesting to see how it all shakes up during quali, especially with it being a lone quali session and not open. It'll be interesting to see the sheer pace without any other cars on track, no draft, no nothing. It'll be interesting to see how it plays out for all these guys. See if we get any shakeups in the top 15.
Yeah, I agree. And I think that, you know, quali is going to be one thing, but a 45-minute race isn't long, but it's not short either. So there's going to be some, you know, strategy involved both within the team and then obviously the top five. It's going to be a pretty close race based on what we're seeing.
Yeah, definitely.
Oh, and...
looks like Trey, yeah.
I was going to say, Noah, I guess we have alternates that are in the race themselves. Eric Kuzman and John Chevecki are the alternates.
They're here just in case. But they're obviously not on track or anything like that.
So that's what we got going on. We have a couple of drivers that are just sitting there just on the off chance that they might be pulled in. All that is, you were saying, I think Trey Mistak goes top of the leaderboard.
Yep.
With a 2:03.8. And for everyone that's tuning in, the relative is pretty simple. You know, you got your position drive, overall position for a driver, their number, their name, the relative between the drivers around them, the manufacturer, their last lap, that pit out, and then how long they were in the pits, as well as positions gained will be on the far right once the race starts. And going over to another driver of Drew Glover, who's the other top driver in the CAS Sim Racing League. Drew Glover did a 2:04.6. That really seems like he, even to be outside of the top 10, even having a 2:04.4 is really where you want to be to get that top 10, as we see Drew Glover spin it, unfortunately, there. It's going to be something for him, as Nick Terrell from OMEC also had to take avoiding action on that one. He's the other driver that's up there. And Noah, what can he say here? We got some speed out of these drivers now, as Jacob Simmons goes to P2. The West Coast Racing guys haven't really responded to that just yet. Chris Chitterling, Jeff Caulfield, 6 and 7 now, putting the West Coast Racing just down a couple positions. Sean, any thoughts there?
Yeah, no, I mean, it's like I said, I really think based on what I'm hearing from you guys and what's going on in my league, it's going to be a tight race. I will say, I think there's a few West Coast Racing guys that have some more time and then they might be just, holding on to that to, play a bit of strategy until quali, not do their very, very best lap. But, at the end of the day, quali is going to be one thing and the race is going to be another. Draft is a big thing here. Passing opportunities. It's a great track for passing overall, but still, it's going to come down to drivers that haven't raced with each other. I think that's going to be a big thing today. In our league races, we race, every week together. So we get to know each other, get to know how other people drive, what their strategies might be a little bit. But all of a sudden we get thrown into this and it's nothing like an official, thankfully. Everyone's going to be a lot cleaner than that. But you don't know the other drivers as well. You don't know, who's more aggressive, who's going to be a little bit more tactical. So that's going to be a big factor.
Yeah, definitely. And it's entirely possible that people are running different programs right now. I wouldn't be surprised to assume that a couple of our drivers are probably running quali sims right now. Even though there's a lot of tight racing going on in practice, which is always fun to see. I would be surprised to see some people running different programs, quality sim or trying to get as much of a tire wear simulator as possible.
Yeah, and one of that said is Broken Wing did do a little bit of a practice before this practice session even started. They I call them the sweats, and just randomly there's this driver of Thomas Sicasio, I think is how you say that. It's definitely a toilet car, as someone pointed out in the chat. I don't know if both of you have seen this on stream just yet, but it is a unique addition from the Can-Am SimSport League. I guess they have a couple funny guys in their league as well. So, you know, the Beans there in the background, you can't ever mistake Beans. You know,
I think we can always appreciate a humorous livery.
Absolutely. And thanks West Coast Racing for the follow, as well as ZD Man 2001. We're trying to make it look fake. No, they're trying to make it. And yeah, with 2 minutes left to go in practice, we're just looking at different drivers that are actually looking to race each other a little bit, even in practice. And that's Chris Lambeth, who right now is in P13. Ooh, I don't know what happened there. That was Omex Nick Terrell.
Yeah, got a little loose coming down the hill, I think.
Oh! I don't know how to... That was something.
Yeah, and I recognize a couple names racing for other teams. I'm pretty sure Mike Braun has raced with us for a little bit.
I believe you're right. Mike Braun has. Omek did take some of the Broken Ring Racing League drivers. I remember seeing a few in the last street fight that were previously Broken Ring Racing League drivers.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Which is fine. You know, everyone finds their footing in different leagues.
Yeah, definitely.
And, you know, look at that. John Schwartz of Omek just set a 203. Now we're seeing some real change. At the beginning of this practice session, it was three drivers with the 203s in their best, but now we have drivers up to P8. And after that, setting a 204.077 with Jeff Coffold leading the 204s. And then onward, you could have a 204 up until P24. And then you're looking at the 205s up until 40, or actually 39. So that's some very tight racing that we're going to see out of these 48 drivers.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's going to be tight all the way through the field. There's going to be good battles from front to back. A big thanks from my side for our two backup drivers on the WCR side. We had a couple of our main drivers, unfortunately, had family issues today, so they weren't able to race. So yeah, last minute we had two people jump in that weren't fully prepared, but you know what? They're here. They're going to give it their best, and it should be a great race.
Really should. I can't wait to see what happens. It's a 10-minute qualifying session. Also, not open qualifying session. Is that correct? It's just going to be...
Yeah. This is going to be a lone quality. Each driver will have two laps, so they'll have their out lap and then two hot laps to set the best time that they possibly can. And it'll be the same conditions for every driver. So, you know, it's really just a test of raw pace as opposed to racecraft or anything else like that.
Yeah, and while the drivers are getting their tires warmed up, maybe we should let the streamers, people watching the stream, know about the prizes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, you wanted to get into that a little bit, Sean?
Yeah, sure. You guys go for it. I'm on the outs on this one. I'm just producing.
Perfect. Yeah. So we've got a couple of things happening for the podium drivers. Obviously, there's bragging rights for the league that wins. There's going to be an overall calculation, it looks like, that's done for between the leagues. So that's an important one. But in addition to that, the top three drivers, so the podium, will all be getting physical trophies mailed to them. That's something that we do in WCR. I actually make the trophies in my wood shop. They're waiting to get laser engraved with the names of the winners. So first, second, and third are getting physical trophies mailed to them. And also first, second, and third, presented by Advanced Motorsports, you see their logo down at the bottom left, are going to be getting access to the Advanced Motorsports Gold training platform, the Founders Club. It's a fantastic program. I'm a part of it myself. You know, a lot of people know Advanced Sim, Advanced Motorsports. They're all over sim racing and real racing. But they've put together an online platform for learning with time trials and, you know, different coaching opportunities and multiple different courses on braking and, you know, simple stuff all the way up to advanced racecraft you know, and techniques. So yeah, that's pretty exciting too, I think, for the podium. So thanks again to Advanced Motorsports for jumping on board and throwing that in. And yeah, I'm looking forward to see who we send the trophies to. I'm hoping that I get to at least put one WCR logo on a trophy, but we'll see. We'll see. I'll put whatever logos are the winners, of course.
Yep. Yeah, great explanation there, Sean. And for all the viewers that we have watching right now, if you go ahead and refresh the browser, you will have the link to Advanced Motorsports' website in our Twitch bio.
As we go on board with Curtis Jones, who I believe was the first driver to actually go out and start his first hot lap here after being on that out lap. Sean, since it's your driver here, do you want to walk us through what maybe you have some insight on Curtis as he's going through this lap?
Yeah, no, like I was saying earlier, Curtis is a great driver, a great competitor. He's been a supporter of the league for many, almost the whole time the league's been around. So it's been good to get to know him. He's a really technical driver, doesn't tend to make a lot of mistakes. I don't want to do the commentator's curse, but doesn't tend to make a lot of the mistakes. And, you know, it's really fair, but a tough competitor, certainly. I've mailed my fair share of trophies over to Curtis. I know that all of the drivers were considering the cars after the update. We, of course, had the iRacing Season 4 update go live, which made some changes to the GP3s. You know, we were talking about BOP, we were talking about a number of different things. It's interesting to see what's going on, whether, you know, it's not going to be just Ferraris like it maybe would have been a few weeks ago. We're seeing Mustangs, we're seeing all sorts of different options out there. So, we'll see how that pans out in quality.
Yeah, definitely. It seems like this new patch of this BOP probably fixed a good bit of the issues. So it seems like it's a pretty level field.
Yeah, I would agree with that, and that's the feedback I was getting from the drivers when we were talking about it in our Discord over the last few days here. They've been testing lots of different setups. You know, Mustang's competitive, Lambo's competitive, Ferrari's not doing too bad. Corvette, depending on your driving style, also is up there. So yeah, it's going to be interesting to see who decides to pick it up, and that's the way it should be. It should be multiple cars are, you know, competitive. So let's see what happens.
Absolutely, as Jacob Simmons takes the top spot with the 203.7. And wow, Zhao Liu of West Coast Racing just did a 203.3. We hadn't seen that even in practice.
Yeah, he likes to hold on to his laps until afterwards. Z, we affectionately just call him Z in the league, and he's a pretty talented guy. He's done real life racing, sim racing professionally. He's got a lot of hats that he wears in real life. So we're lucky to have him in the league, and you know, definitely we all learn a lot from him. And I would say that 203 is not even the fastest. 203.3 is not even the fastest he's going to go tonight.
Wow, that's impressive. He holds a 4/10 gap to Peter Flanner, who's sitting in P2 with Jacob Simmons behind in 3. And then Omek of Scott Kimbrown, the highest driver for Omek, is in P4, as well as we're looking at the Cast drivers. Who's following that up? And I think that is going to be Drew Glover with the 204.5. And I guess the times are going to continue to change. Anyone here that I'm actually kind of curious about that hasn't set a time, Trey Mistak has not set a time. What about Zachary Bowman or Jordan Smith or David Schmidt, Sean? They have not set times just yet.
Yeah, I mean, they'll get a time on the board, I'm sure, in quali, but you know, they're going to be solid in this pack. In our races, they're towards the front of this pack. I think they'll probably be, you know, solid 10 to 15 guys. But never know, it might surprise me.
All right.
Yeah, this is it's a quality field all the way across.
You know, with 3 minutes, 23 seconds to go, I think that Trey did not go out initially on his outlap. He was sitting in the pit lane for a little bit. So he is definitely going to go to the end here on this. This is his second hot lap. You know, going P6, I am going to be surprised. No, I expected more from Trey thus far with a lap on the board. It's a 204 even, a 204.008, which basically is even. He's got to find about 7/10 this lap if he's going to want to take the top step in qualifying.
Yeah, he was doing pretty fast times. If I remember correctly, it was mid to low 203s in practice. So it could be that he just had a minor slip up in that lap. But it could also just be that maybe his setup on the Ferrari feels more comfortable midway through a stint. We'll see how this lap goes. He's typically pretty good with his one lap pace. Try not to commentators curse him, but we'll obviously see how he does here.
He's rounding the carousel right now. He's got a few more corners to contend with before he completes this lap.
Yeah, I'm excited to see how the start goes down too, because we were talking about it before we jumped on the stream here. The start is going to be very different for the WCR team, who are used to going on green, not going off of the lead driver's pace. So if it does end up being Z, he's obviously raced lots of different ways. He knows how to do that, but the rest of the guys, it will be a different way of starting for them for sure.
Yeah, absolutely. And we have not rated anyone's liveries besides the toilet there on Omicron. And thank you for the Prime sub, John Javecki, Dia01 for following, and a large tire for the follow as well. Anyone else I forgot? John B, K Scythe, everyone that's just joining us for this street fight. Thanks. And Trey Miss Echoes P3 with that remaining lap. And we still have Zhao Liu, as you said, he's out there, and he's got a minute and 16 to go. He's the only driver that is actually out there. Oh, and just getting some extra practice in, I guess.
Yeah, he probably realized he doesn't need to go again. Possibly, I don't know, actually, since it's not open quality. Or he just, might have had a little hiccup early in the lap and knew he wasn't going to do a better time. But yeah, it seems like we have Emery still trying to set a lap. But other than that, that should be it. It looks like
just kind of rolling through.
I don't think he's going to be setting a 2:03.2 here, but you never know.
Maybe he wants to nurse that engine.
Yeah, the rest maybe that final sector will be pretty nasty.
And here we have the grid from P1 to P15. You can see on the board, so we're going to scroll past them on the starting. It's Omex, Mike Brown in P16, Chris Lambert in 17, Joshua Grosso 18, Nick Terrell in 19, Robert Crivelli in 20, Andrew Porstecki in 21, Rodrigo Theory in 22, Robert Lowry in 23, Brandon Fick in 24, JD Daniel 25, Brian Berthium in 26, Tony Casado in 27, Nathan Sides 28, Mitch Buenaventura in 29, James Hansen 30, Kevin Hayes this third in 31, Flavio Barros in 32, Jeff Lacey in 33, Jordan Smith 34, Brendan Grabo in 35, David Schmidt in 36, Luca Philippone in 37, Michael Doyen in 38, Jansu Pardo, Luke Patrick in 40, Evan Gramke in 41, Evan Adams 42, Chris Kraus in 43, Zachary Bowman in 44, Alex Petrovsky in 45, Bob Lindell in 46, Emery Anderson in 47, and Thomas Saki Sasso, I don't know that last one, 48, I'm sorry on that one, Cass, I definitely don't know how to say that.
I was looking at the names going, wow, you're doing a good job, so don't worry about that. I think you did about as well as you could with not having names before. Happy to see 48 people on the grid, because that was what the poster said, 48 drivers, and we've got them. So let's see how this runs on this start here.
Yep. Yeah, and we'll be doing a full formation lap here, so drivers will have ample time to try and get their brakes up to temperature and try and figure out a game plan for how this race start will go.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Although, even with a full formation lap, one thing we always say in our league, cold tires in the first corner, gentlemen. You can't win a 45-minute race in the first corner, but you certainly can lose one.
Yeah, I'm pretty certain my guys are pretty tired and can probably recite that exact thing that I normally say, word for word. I always, like you stress, there is no reason to go guns blazing into turn one when you have an entire 44 more minutes to win the race. But, you know, I think with the competition and with, you know, each driver representing their league, I would assume and hope that each driver will want to put on, you know, a respectful showing.
Absolutely.
So we'll definitely see how it plays out here.
You can see those TAS drivers in the teal, or not teal, but pink and orange, really sporting a very specific style of livery, a color palette for a lot of those drivers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they definitely win the marketing award for sure. Yeah, the cars, you can see them. I mean, we've got a number of PSM guys that are WCR drivers. So you'll see the Pacific Sim Motorsports logoed cars, purple, red, green, all different like primary colors, but big PSM logos. And yeah, the rest of the WCR guys are going to be a mix of different liveries. A lot of them sporting our logo, some not, especially our two backup drivers that found out like 2 hours ago that they're racing tonight. So it's okay, they get a pass for not having the logo this time.
Yeah,
it'll be interesting to see how, because we obviously have Peter, Trey, and Jacob rounding out second, third, and fourth. So it'd be interesting to see if they have some game plan to try and steal first a couple corners into the race. See if they can't game plan something to stay ahead.
You saying there's a little shaking and baking going on to get caught
possibly,
up there?
Possibly. You know, through the power of, Jacob Simmons is known for bringing the power of Bush's baked beans into iRacing, so you never know. Never know.
Yeah, well, I know that a WCR guys definitely have not talked about how to work together as a team to
replace this.
So it's I'm quite surprised to hear that.
No, it's every man for themselves, right?
Exactly. Yeah. Also, anyone listening that doesn't know, I'm sarcastic like every second word out of my mouth. So no worries. we're all going to be pulling as a team and working together.
Understandable, guys. And for everyone just joining us, my name is Jason Alvarez. I'm commentating for Brooklyn Ring Racing League, as well as Noah Hodgkinson, who's the representative, and Sean McStay is with West Coast Racing, and we don't have representatives for the other two, OMEC and Cass, but we will still be thinking about them and try to get a good read on their racers as they, we go racing soon. We've just gotten through the kink right now.
Yep. And in case any of the viewers aren't familiar, essentially the way that it works is P1 gets 60 points, P2 gets 58, P3 56, and then so on down in increments of two. And the top eight drivers for each team are the ones that score. So basically, each league wants their eight drivers to have the most aggregate points overall. So that's kind of what everybody's gunning for.
And low amount of incident points as well.
Yes, correct.
Incident points are going to be working against them. There's a whole gaggle of cars, 48 drivers on the grid. Only one champion can be named. And is there a safety car?
There will not be any safety car.
No safety car. Okay, you heard it there in the chat.
Yeah, low precautions only, so slow down as you will, and get back to racing.
Yep.
And Zhao Liu will take us to green. And they're off, and he's got a clear advantage.
They're off. Yep. Kind of.
And I'm not really familiar with the. That was a bit of a zigzag for him heating up the tires before turn one. And those drivers off in the back.
It looks like there's a little bit of contact back there. But yeah, he was weaving up the tires a little bit, but it wasn't, there weren't risking contact or anything, so it's not not too much of a problem. I don't blame Z for wanting to get his tires warmed up at the very beginning.
Yeah, it's especially on that Mustang. Rear tires need all they can get.
Yeah, most definitely.
And that was John Jovecki. Or, no, J.D. Daniel, I believe. Oh. Here we go. J.D. Daniel, Brooklyn Racing League, the Pax Oceani purple driver. He was just up on that curve.
Yep, looks like he lost him by himself.
Yeah. So we'll go back over.
Held his brakes, didn't get back on the racing line until it was clear, so that's all you can ask for.
Yeah, most definitely.
And further back, we have Omec Scott Kimbrough, who we knew was going to be a strong contender. He was one of the only Omec drivers in the top 10. He's sporting P6 right now. From P1 to P8, there's been no change in the order. Positions gained for Chris Brunemmer. Hey, do you want to have a crack at there, Sean?
Oh, yeah, Chris Brunemmer and Dustin Smith.
Brunemmer. Okay.
Pulling their way up a little bit. But, the top 10 is... spread out a little bit, but that's going to close up pretty soon, I would guess.
Yeah, it's definitely, it's a long race, and there's going to be, obviously, pit stops involved for fuel. Mm-hmm. So there's usually some good margin for error and very minuscule time gains that you can have with entering and exiting the pits. Yeah. And it's definitely a place where you can lose a crucial tenth, and that really can make a big difference.
Talking about gains, we have Tony Casado in 25, Nathan Sides in 26 at the OMEC, gaining two positions,
yep.
And James Hansen of WCR ahead with three positions gained, and Brian Berthium of Broken Ring Racing League having to defend against a driver of Mitch Buenaventura, and I think he gets him here of OMEC Racing. Oh yeah, he got him on the inside line, and now we're going to see some drivers battling it out, not giving it up just yet.
Well, definitely some nice, tight, respectful racing happening here. Happy to see, mostly clean for that first lap, outside of the curb taking the one driver out at the beginning there. But some great racing. Just so the people watching know, what's the fuel limit we're working with today?
50%, so it's pretty stock standard for 45-minute races. Should lead to a pit stop about halfway through the race, if not a little bit after halfway.
Yeah, that's makes a lot of sense. That's what we run for our 40 and 40-45, our 40-minute races. Our 60-minute races, we typically do 60% fuel. Yeah. A little bit more strategizing, but everyone's going to be pitting. No one's fuel saving their way to a no-stop today.
And we could already see the aliens are kind of getting away from the pack in the top 10. David, we were on with Dustin Smith here of WCR. He's going battling it back with John Schwartz. He's on the outside, John Schwartz here. Ooh! And they're both out. Oh, wow! John was able to get right back into it, but that driver behind is now gonna lose out there a little bit, unfortunately.
Yeah, sad to see Dustin go off. He's a great driver. He'll get back on track and work his way through. Looks like he's gonna jump into the pits for a quick repair if there is one. He's based in Las Vegas. It's probably about 130 degrees Fahrenheit in his sim right now. He also is known in our league for having the largest screens on any of the sims that we have. He runs triple 65 4Ks. His sim takes up an entire room in his house.
Chris Lambeth goes through on Nick Terrell of the OMEC driver. The beans livery. You can iconically see the beans.
Gave him the beans.
And I think that's Joshua Grosso there in the background. Also might have a go at Nick Terrell. He's going to take the defensive line into turn 5.
Yeah. Josh Grosso is—he's one of my normal teammate in our series. He's also a fellow admin for Broken Ring Racing League, and he's a mainstay on our endurance team. So I wouldn't be too surprised. We both primarily drive the Porsche, so he knows that car pretty much inside and out. So I'd be looking for him to start making some moves, getting up the field.
And there is tight, close racing between everybody on this track. We're going to be looking over at Luke Patrick, who has gained 5 positions. Ahead of him is David Adams. Ooh.
He caught it. Yeah, did good to get the car stopped there.
Yeah, I mean, commentators just have a way of looking at some drivers and hitting them in the worst possible moment for their screen time.
The commentator's curse is real.
Really is. There's JD Daniel, 13 positions lost for him as he's in P38 in the background there.
Yeah, I feel bad for Luke. I was happy to see him up 5 spots. He's one of the few guys that, he's getting his haircut, I think, and found out that he was racing tonight. But he'll pick it back on track and hopefully make up some of those spots.
Yep. And the fresh haircut will give him the confidence he needs.
Going back to the top 5, or the top 10 here, or looking at the top 10, top 5 at the moment, Trey Mystack in P3 looked like he had a little bit more of a run on Peter Flaner. They're holding out the 2-3-4 Broken Ring Racing League, whilst Curtis Jones is just behind there in that Ford. I know it's a Ford this time. I can check. I see the logos. Sean, that's just a little inside joke. I called. There was only Chevys on the on a race. No one was in a Ford, and I kept saying Ford the entire time. I don't know why. I had a couple Red Bulls that day.
I bet there was only a few people dying to hear their Chevys call the Ford.
There's a couple people that had made mention to me, and at some point I did look over and see that it was it was the Corvette, and then I was like, well, I've already made my bet, I'm just gonna sleep in it now. But look at the difference there. Zhao Liu is in, he's got a 3.4 second gap, 3.5 to a P2, and then if you look even further back, there's Cody Johnston and Chris Brunemer, sorry if I said that wrong there. There's a little bit of gap there from P7 to P8, but those 6 and 7 are holding up, and they're still with the the top drivers there. As we can even go further up, there's the beans of Jacob Simmons having to defend against Scott Kimbrough of Omec Racing.
Yeah, Cody and Chris, they've raced a lot together, so those two will stick together pretty close, I think. Curtis is, he might be biding his time a little bit. He's a fast driver. And we'll see if as we affectionately call him our robot alien overlord, he continues his pace.
Oh, gotcha.
Yeah, he's definitely a monster with the pace. With us holding out 2, 3, and 4, it's going to be pretty crucial that we hold those positions, especially with Zhao running away with first, almost out of touch already. It'll be pretty important that that Peter Trey and Jacob hold on to these positions, and then hopefully buy time for Chris Chitterling and Elliot and Jeff to make their way up the field.
Yeah, and it's a tight battle between Chris in front, Chris in the middle there, Chris Chitterling, and then Cass's Drew Glover, who's sitting right there in that 10th spot, and Zhao Liu, I'm sorry for that pronunciation there. Is there anyone else that I blunder? Let me know.
Yeah, Chris is generally one of our more talented drivers. Typically does a really good job. His racecraft is probably one of the more shining positives of his sim racing talents. So I would be interested to see if and when and how he manages to get by and make that position.
A little puff of smoke, but I'm not sure what that was about. So we have these two Omec. Cass versus Omec there, as a driver just gets ahead of Robert Lowry in the 14.
Yeah, Robert Lowry and Nathan are battling it out, and that's opened the door a bit for James Hansen to come and say, oh, I wouldn't mind a couple extra positions here, guys. Keep it up.
Yeah, when you're in James' shoes there, you're hoping they bang doors a couple times.
Hopping over, we have Chris Lambeth, Andrew Korostecki, a melee between P15 onto 20 here, and they are so close. Joshua Grasso still maintaining his position enough to open the start of this race here. Whoa! What was that out of Andrew Korostecki?
Yeah, there's a curb there that can pretty easily throw you off. It can be pretty nasty. Yeah, I'm interested to see if Josh accidentally sends him.
No assistance necessary. Yeah, he lost that on his own.
That curb will do it.
And look how close Brandon Thicke is to Mike Braun of the OMAC. It's like Chris Lambert that's getting ahead of Josh Grosso there. Was that Sean?
How many quicker pairs do these guys have to work with? One?
Yeah, they have one faster pair, and then it's 12 incident points for your first drive-through, and then every six afterwards. So that 12 incident count drive-through is going to be a pretty big factor later in the race. That 12 sneaks up on you quick.
Look at that, Mike or Mitch Buenaventura of OMEC Racing out there, Flavio Barros, and they're side by side going into turn five. A couple of drivers want to join them. Ooh. That was Michael Doyen who just went.
Yep.
Oh. Nope.
Nope. Don't rejoin.
Nope. Don't do it.
I think he did.
Yeah, we'll have to watch that one back. But,
that's tough.
Not holding the brakes.
That's two drivers ahead of him. Mitch Buenaventura is still battling out Fabio Barros, so they are still going neck and neck, lap after lap.
So, probably a good time after that to talk about what are we going to do with any penalties or stewarding that's required?
So for this specifically, for this specific street fight, there won't be any in-race or post-race stewarding. It's just going to be the incentive to keep your incident count as low as humanly possible for the extra 5 points if you keep it under a certain threshold. But post-race stewarding can definitely be looked at for future races, but for this one, sadly, there wasn't anything put in place.
Fair enough.
And for the back, Zachary Bowman, every position matters here, especially in this race. These drivers are the top 12 fastest drivers in their league, and they're all battling in a street fight, so it's no slouch here. Zachary Bowman of WCR, and Sean, what can you tell me about this driver? So it looks like he's going to make this move on Cass's Evan Gramke.
Yeah, Zach's a great driver. He's our other backup that got kind of called in last minute. But still a fast guy. We were fortunate to have a pretty deep bench for this race. Everyone was excited about it. But Zach's been racing with us for a while. He's won some championships. Commentator's curse is supposed to be kind of real today, guys. That was
yikes. Sorry to say.
He got helped on that one.
Yeah, I think he did too. I'm just going to go ahead and correct myself live on air here. In regards to post-race penalties, we are able to assess time penalties at admin discretion for anytime somebody does something deliberate to gain time or gain an advantage, or particularly egregious infractions and incidents, which that previous one down at turn five, I believe it is. Is what I would consider. So we'll have to discuss that and take a look at that afterwards.
Yeah, I think that's reasonable. If anyone has anything they want to appeal with it, they can just, you know, reach out to whichever one of their league owners they belong to, and we can take a look at it.
Hopping on board, and just look at the beauty of these drivers here. Joshua Grosso's leading this little train here, and he's in front. And actually, Chris Lambert just got ahead of him, and we can't see that in focus, but there he is, the beans with that blue, baby blue in the background there on his rear end. Leading this pack is Cass's Robert Lowry, looking to have a go at, I think that's Tony Casado.
Yeah, it looks like he did some tire cooling on the grass there on exit.
And they're still going for it into the next turn.
Yeah, I remember Bob Lindell, who is the guy that runs OMEC. When the last street race we did, he was mentioning how Tony Casado is kind of their notorious elbows out driver, who isn't really going to give anything up for free. So it'll be interesting to see how that race goes with Tony and his close opponent.
Yeah, back on board with the drivers in the top five here is Curtis Jones. Really hindered by the Broken Ring Racing League. Three drivers, of Peter Flanagan, Trey Mesekin, Josh, Jacob Simmons. That's got to be, there's got to be a lot of team play here for these drivers to keep some pace with each other, but also look at, they're not going to let anyone by, and Curtis Jones has been plenty close. Scott Kimbrough as well. And again, P1 through P7, no positions changed since the start of this race, and we're on lap 8.
Yeah, Curtis is often up, chasing after Z pretty close, so these guys are doing a good job keeping him behind, and we'll see how long it goes for and how the pit strategies will work.
Yeah, I think pit strategy, especially for these P2 Ooh. Through 7, is going to be a huge thing. It looks like...
Definitely is. That is Cody Johnson going through on Scott Kimbrough, who I think just made a mistake because he slowed down on the exit of that corner, and that just let Cody Johnson by.
It looks like Cassius Pardo just towed.
Speaking of Bob Lindell, the OMEC guy, here he is in P37. He's got Chris Krause behind him. A league friend, as well as Luke Patrick and WCR and Emery Anderson right behind as well. All these drivers are on pace with each other right now.
Yep. Yeah, and I know Emery Anderson specifically is a sub for Can-Am. And he's another one that didn't know that they were racing until this afternoon, basically.
Oh, man. So
very
impressive
last minute
for him.
Thing, so.
And there's David Adams of OMEC Racing. And Ben Grabeau. That doesn't sound right, but
there's definitely a lot of really close racing. It seems like these drivers trust each other a good deal for having, for the most part, never raced with each other before.
Absolutely,
side by side through corners, which is really nice to see. Commentator's curse again.
Sort of, yeah, but I mean they were side by side. We could take another look at this. It looked like he wasn't going to give him the room, and that's when.
Yeah, it seems like that room, on first glance, obviously, never really existed, but.
Yeah.
That's the nature of racing. It's a split second decision that's going to have life or death consequences.
That was, in terms of an endurance race, you would probably just let the guy have the room but that was a defensive line they were going for. The door was kind of closed, and then it opened up. That's Andrew Korostecki there in the blue.
I don't know if we have time. Contact with anybody who's in the race, but we'll have to make sure somebody saves the replay just in case there are any reviews that we need to do.
Yep, definitely.
Yeah, going forward, another addition of these races, it's nice to see different leagues coming together, showing a lot of respect. I mean, as it stands, that is a very slippery exit for Andrew Korostecki. I think he's going to lose his position to JD Daniel here.
And they're probably, if I had to guess, communicating telepathically, of course.
Oh, look at that little push, though. Not a push. It looks like that from the angle, but, he just stayed right there on the bumper of Luca Filippone.
Yeah.
Filippone, probably. I would say Filippone, maybe. I think it's... And I think he's... I think he's going to keep it. For now, he's up 6 positions. Now JD's gonna stay in that draft for Andrew here. And Andrew, of course, Korostecki's gonna go through.
Clean by, and JD's setting it up himself.
And it'll be a little bit later, and then we have Alex Petrovsky of Can-Am Sim Sport. and the iconic Ferrari livery there. It's can't go wrong with that. Up 8 positions, so is Bob Lindell. Really impressive for some of these guys where they're at right now. Going over to Brian Berthume. Conway Critty, thank you for the follow, as well as Colossal Lockup just seconds ago. Appreciate that, guys.
Yeah, I know we've got a healthy chat going in our Discord here talking about the race, so happy to see a lot of people watching and enjoying the racing, and definitely want to thank the guys who put this series on for inviting us this this time around. It's been fun preparing for it, and so far it's been a blast to watch.
Yeah, I think this kind of competition is always really good to see between you know, leagues with similar series. Gives the drivers a chance to switch it up a little bit and work together to take on other leagues as well, which is a fun kind of competition.
Agreed.
Absolutely. And that fish sticks. Hi, my name is Kyle. Thank you for the follows. It was an interesting choice of names there. The gap is, the field is kind of spreading out. The nature of the pace of what people are doing lap by lap is showing more and more. But we still have some drivers that are really just, they're keeping close eyes. Luke Patrick of WCR. He's been, you know, on the door of Thomas of Can-Am SimSport, driver ahead in that, I would say, iconic livery there. The toilet livery. It's a good view of that.
Yeah, I'm stoked to see Luke back up. I don't want to say his name with that back end of that Mustang. So happy to turn around on him. But he had that spin earlier in the race after being up 5 spots, and he's still out there, still pushing. So good on you. Luke's one of our admin and just an all-around super nice guy. He does a lot of great stuff in the league. So happy to see him out there.
And Trey Mistak. It's the first driver to go into the pit lane.
Yeah, Trey is usually very he's spot on with his pit choices. He's not afraid to take a risk, whether it pays off or whether it doesn't. He's usually the first one to decide whether he's going to go long or going to go short. So it's interesting to see if this attempted undercut works out for him.
And another driver who's gone in out of the pit lane is Chris Krause of OMAC Racing there in P45.
Seem to be a lap down.
Yeah, I saw a good number of drivers pulling into the pit lane, I think, as we went past there. So I think it's getting to be that time, lap 12 of 22. Z is known for being a prodigious fuel saver, sometimes getting like 2 or 3 laps more than others when he feels like it. So it'll be interesting to see when he decides to go in.
And here's Robert Lowry of S. Looked like he was going to have a go at Rodrigo Theory on the start straight finish, but it's just been tucked under him for the rest of his lap so far.
Got loose a little bit there. Dip his tire into the dirt, but he did well to catch it there.
And Zihao Leo is still out there in P1 with a 6-second gap to Peter Flanner. It'd be interesting to see when this driver goes in. Is it going to be now? Is he going to wait? He's been really putting on a clinic here, though, folks. It is him and only him at the front. You can't even see drivers behind him that are his competition.
Yeah, he's definitely a resident alien, it seems.
Absolutely. It's got to feel pretty nice there, Sean.
Oh, well, you know, we had to strong arm him into making sure that he was in here once we heard about the event happening. So it's nice that he was able to fit it in between all the other stuff that he does. But he's a great guy, too. Like, yeah, he's an alien. He's super quick. But, man, we all learn from him when we race with him. And he's a super, super nice dude.
Yeah, and P4 of Curtis I think it's P5, actually. Sorry, he was P5, Curtis Jones, into the pits. Omek driver of, I think that's Scott Kimbrough there also just missed his pit box just by a little bit. And Cody Johnson of WCR also already out there. Car number 7, he's that yellow one, he's popping out. It's Curtis Jones, he gets jumped by his league mate there. And Peter Flanner, Jacob Simmons, they're still with it. Chris Chittering behind is also there. Elliot Burton. I think all of the BWRL right now from P2 to P6, they have stayed out so far. Now we'll see which Trey Misak is at. The stint right now is JD Daniel behind has not gone in the pit lane, so he is P12. He's going to lose some positions there. Cody Johnson and Curtis Jones are behind in P13 and 14. You can see them in the background, that neon yellow and purple for the WCR drivers there in the Ford Mustangs. Got it.
There you go.
And that's really the competition. Trey Misak was right there with Peter Flanner and Jacob Simmons. Be interesting to see where they come out in relation and whether or not the undercut is going to work out for these drivers. We haven't seen the over and undercut yet. Cody and Curtis hit, not maybe as a response to Trey, but just hit the next lap, and it didn't work out for them for one lap. So it's unfortunate to see that. But here we have Peter Flanner and also Zihao Leo also in the pit lane. Now all the drivers coming in, Nick Carroll, Joshua Grasso, Rodrigo Theory, and Jeff Lacey of Cass. And now where's Trey Misak?
Well, it's been interesting to see if that thirsty Mustang pit stop is going to impact, because a lot of these top guys are running it, but it definitely is a little bit longer if you look at the pit times than some of the other racers. So we'll see if that that adds up to anything.
Yeah, and look at that.
Trey came out definitely on top there.
What a fantastic, as you said, Noah, he does a little bit of different of pit strategy, and that worked out for him. He just overtook the other BWR drivers and is now in P2. Peter Flanner now in 3. Cody Johnson was able to get ahead of Jacob Simmons there.
Yeah, it seems like undercut was definitely the play there, because Cody Johnson had pitted obviously a little bit before, and he overtook Jacob in the pits. So it's that undercut definitely worked out for Cody. But we'll interested to see if Jacob tries to make a move on him here. We'll definitely see how this plays out.
Yeah, I mean, and looking at the positions gained on the far right there, worked out for Trey, didn't work out for Peter, worked out for Cody Johnson. Jacob Simmons, Curtis Jones, Scott Kimbrough, not worked out for them as well, so unfortunate. And look at that time, too. It was a 46.4 is what he put in on a lap, and that's, you know, that's a good 2 seconds where he really showed his difference there in time.
Yeah, I think, you know, 45-minute races, obviously there's absolutely no need for tires, so that kind of removes that from the equation entirely, pun not intended. But anyways, it really comes down to fuel usage on the cars, because, I mean, even a couple extra liters in the thirstier cars will make a difference for sure.
Oh.
Oh, man, that looks like... looks like Jacob was involved.
Looking back at that, we're going to see, looks like he, ooh.
Yeah, it looks like Jacob tried to apex and that room just wasn't there.
Yeah.
See that again, obviously.
Well, if we look at it, it looks like Curtis Jones has that inside, but he hits a curb there, which bumps into Jacob as Jacob was on the outside on that corner. And both having a resulting... that's a net loss there for Jacob Simmons there, as he is tumble down the order off of that.
Yeah, definitely unfortunate. Car was there for sure at the corner, but we'll see what happens.
That's Cody Johnston having a move there on Peter Flanner, P3, and he looks like he has it down. Stuck it down. No, it's not over just yet, as Peter Flanner is out there on the outside, and now he's going to tuck in on this next one. So I think move done for Cody Johnston. Bushes in the bushes. That's a... Jacob Simmons was in the Bush's Baked Beans livery, so that was a little pun that someone made in chat there. And that BWRO 2 and 3 is now 2 and 4. But also WCR with the 1-3 finish. Omek of Scott Kimbrough really showing Omek's pace there. And he's in the top 10. He's P5 right now. He's really doing strong there. And Cass of Drew Glover, the other driver of the other league, that's sitting there in P9.
Yeah, I mean, the competition from looks like P3 on down is pretty tight. Obviously, Z Hound's running away with it, and then Trey got himself a nice lead. Or not lead, but you know, gap in the second. So we'll see how Peter and Cody battle it out for the rest of the race.
Yes, we have Mike Bowman of WCR. Looked like he was trying to make a move there on Drew Glover of Can-Am SimSport.
Yeah, Mike's a good driver. He's absolutely lethal in a formula car. He's pretty darn good in a tin top too, as he's showing today, being in the top 10. But he's a calculated guy, so I'm curious to see where exactly he tries to make that pass stick.
So far, just following suit. Maybe he'll make a move later on, but Elliot Burton there in P8, staying ahead. Looking over here at Kevin Hayes the third on Tony Casado, both drivers of Omek in 20 and 21. I don't know if we've seen thus far league drivers racing each other hard for position. We've seen swaps. I would say that some drivers have swapped and not really like just try to make it easy. I haven't really seen them battling it out against each other, so be interesting to see if Kevin and Tony Casado here end up doing that, battling it out, or they're just trying to maintain some pace.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to see for sure. like I mentioned about Tony before, if you're Tony behind, I definitely expect to see it. But I don't know enough about Kevin to know how he is as a racer, and if he'd you know, rather stay behind, not risk anything, or if he wants that position for himself.
Absolutely. And to be honest, we haven't really seen it. So far in this race, we haven't seen two drivers of the same league initials there go at it down a straight or otherwise. They've been close, but they haven't actually... I think they've been really more respectful in that regard, not trying to make any moves there.
I think the three BWRL guys that were second, third, and fourth for a while there were playing it smart, working together, trying to see what they could do, you know, at least off the start to catch back up. But now we're pretty split all the way down the order there, looking at the relatives, you know, between the different leagues. So should make for some interesting racing here, as we see a thought about a pass, at least, from Jordan Smith there.
Yeah, he just actually got lapped, he got passed on that straight by Brian. That's what ended up happening there.
Yeah, definitely. And you know, I think it'll be interesting too with, you know, obviously the top eight scoring the points for your league. If you hit that incident threshold, you get 5 points if you keep it low enough, which is really comes out to two and a half positions that can make, which can make a really big difference in the grand scheme of things. It'll be interesting to see if people are playing it safe and it ends up impacting the final standings.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm curious to see how much go Trey's got left after that really short stop. Looks like he gained about 4 seconds on the guys that were close to him, so he underfueled a bit. He might be lifting and coasting a little bit towards the end.
Possible. Looking over here at Curtis Jones, who's in P29, down 24 positions. Just behind him is Jacob Simmons, also in 30, down 26. Unfortunate for these two in the incident, but we'll probably see these two claw a couple positions before these five laps are done.
Yeah, Curtis will keep racing. He's a mentally tough guy. I mean, obviously that incident was pretty darn unfortunate, but he'll push his way back up as far as he can, for sure.
And there's one as you go that's just barely neatly done for him. Taking back that 24, now it's 23 loss. Ooh, 22. You know, some people, that was Brian Berthium, I believe.
Yeah.
We take those. I'm sure he's thinking that. That's a game. It's unfortunate when you see that, but if someone's beached and that is for position, good on ya.
Yeah, it seems like Cody and Peter are really. It seems like Peter's getting closer and closer to Cody, and maybe trying to make a run at that final podium spot.
Yeah, separated by half a second. He hasn't really left the driver. Ooh, I think that's Cody blinked just a little bit there, but looking closer at Trey Mystak on Zihao Leo. 8.4 sec, 8.5 second gap there. The last lap for him was different.
Call him Z. He goes by Z, he's happy with it.
Z? Okay, we'll do that. Looking at their last lap, you can see that was a 205.2. Trey Mystak was a 204.9, so he is eating into that time. I don't know how much of that is gonna... It's not enough for the end of this race.
Yeah, it's gonna... we'll see. I mean, there's obviously traffic coming up, possibly. He's got to make sure that everyone else is being respectful of it. He's pretty good at telling people where they are allowed to put their car. So I don't see that'll be an issue, barring anybody doing something crazy.
Now, I gotta ask, Sean, how is your guys' voice chat when you guys are racing? Are you guys in the Discord voice chat right now, all the drivers? Is everyone very calm and no one's really saying anything over the chat unless they have to? Or do you have a couple rowdy guys making some noise?
We tend to keep it pretty locked down in voice chat during the race. You know, some people have their own little side chat channels that they'll go into, but yeah, after the driver's meeting, it's pretty quiet in league races. Today, obviously, I'm not listening, but I'm guessing most people on the voice chat at least are excited, but not doing too crazy. The text chat's blowing up, though. I'm getting a lot of my good insights from the text chat here, so we'll keep watching what you guys are saying.
Is there any strategy trying to help each other out, the WCR drivers? Or they're talking to each other in any regard? They're like, hey, man, I'm still stuck behind this guy. Can you help me out? Or is there any of that happening?
Not that I've seen or seen anybody talking about. I know a few of the guys are in the chat, and I haven't seen them mention it. I think, you know, looking at the standings, most of the WCR guys are pretty spread out now, so...
Yeah, they work together.
opportunity for teamwork there.
They were together for a time, so it could have been. I know, Noah, I'm sure you can have some insight on this, but when Peter, Trey, and Jacob were all together, there was probably a little bit of chatter on how they were going to maintain their pace, their positions. I feel like there was a bit more team aspect as far as the league goes. Ooh, it looks like they almost banged doors on the, I think they did.
They did, yeah. But yeah, you know, when they were 2, 3, and 4 and Jacob was behind, you know, I'm sure that they were keeping it professional and keeping it, you know, trying to figure out what's best for the team. But I'm sure Jacob, you know, being the last in that train, probably thought that he, might have been a little bit quicker and should have a shot, but you know, they play the team game. They know it's a team game, so that's just what I would assume at least.
Mike Bowen making good use of Drew Glover there of Can-Am SimSport. Gets him on the straightaway. Nicely done. But is it over? It's like Drew Glover's tucking into that slipstream, make use of it. We haven't really seen a battle, you know, the Fords versus the Chevrolets, the Corvettes, I should say. But it looks like the Mustang's going to stay ahead for now. We'll go over to Devin Adams making up a position on Andrew Korostecki. Not sure what happened there, but he had to go.
Yeah, it seemed like Stecki went in the pits.
Yeah, might have been serving a penalty because he didn't take tires or anything, or he didn't. That's a 29-second pit, so I'm not sure what exactly happened there.
Possible it could have been a drive-through.
Yeah, people are going to start seeing those.
Yeah. It's, you know, that 12 incident points catch up with you quick. I mean, one incident, like, you know, one for us. I don't know, Mike Brown seems to have gone off there.
One of the only drivers in an Audi, and yeah, he just... Yeah. And good on him for letting that roll back a little bit before putting the brakes on, just so he can truly not be in the way. Unfortunate for him. Two laps to go. Can JD Daniel make up a position here on Jordan Smith of WCR, that BMW?
JD is generally a really quick driver. Him and there's a core team called Pax Oceani that he's obviously sporting the livery of. But they're big players in our league, and he's one of the faster ones. He's typically up at the front. So he had an incident earlier in the race, but I'm not surprised to see him ending up clawing his way back through the field.
And not only that, made the move down, and he's looking to get about a half second distance there on the gap there. And Mike Bowen now getting closer than ever on Elliot Burton of BWR versus MCR, or sorry, WCR. I was thinking about something else there. Just jumps out of the way.
Yeah, big group here. He's probably trying to dummy a move, either that or the car ahead of him checked up on the brakes a little bit quickly. But yeah, not surprised to see a couple dummy moves here and there. But Elliot does a good job of not getting phased. So we'll see if he's able to disregard the cars behind him and start making a charge at Chris Brenham or in front of him.
Yeah, I would agree with you. Elliot is what I would consider a clinical driver. There's not a lot of things that are going to make him jump out and have any emotion towards. He's just focused strongly on where he's at. Always doing really well in the league races as well, finishing in the top five.
Yeah, he's a very calculated driver. He takes a lot of fine tuning for his setups. He tends to pay a lot of attention to the really small details, which helps him out in the long run.
At the back, we have Nick Carell of OMAC. It's looks like he's getting a little bit closer.
Getting on the final lap here, and it looks like that battle between third and fourth is getting close.
If we can ride on with Peter here, and it's gonna be probably some last ditch efforts here. Peter's a really respectful driver. He's not gonna do anything unfair or anything crazy. But Peter does know that it's crunch time here. So it'll be interesting to see if he's able to set himself up for a run into the final couple corners. Maybe try and overtake a Canada. But 5/10 in these GT3 cars, with as little draft as they have, it can be a long way. So it's probably on Cody to keep it together and not have a little mistake that would allow Peter to catch up. It's a long lap. Anything can happen.
Through the carousel they go. He's still half a second off. Not sure where he's going to try to gain this time right now.
Yeah, I agree. I think the person who will not be named, I'm not going to commentate or curse another one of my guys. I would have to make a mistake for anything to change here, but this has been some great racing. They've been, back and forth a couple of tenths all race long.
And, going through the field in this entire race, it's really seemed like there's been a lot of really close racing, which is good to see.
A lot of close racing.
Other than this guy.
Yeah. Other than this guy who got away easily, and with only a couple corners to contend with, no corners to contend with, the start straight finish, Z goes through to take the championship spot out of 48 drivers, four leagues. Great result for West Coast Racing. Trey Mystak is going to hit P2. And Cody Johnson, right there in the background, he's going to hold that third step for WCR, and Peter Flanner in fourth as he's going through. And Omek, what a finish for him of Scott Kimbrough in P5.
Yeah, did a great job.
Chris Chittering in 6, Chris in 7, Elliot Burton not able to make a move there for P7. He goes to P8, Mike Bowen in 9, Drew Glover in 10, Jeff in 11, Brandon Fick in 12, Chris Lambert in 13, Nick Terrell 14, Rodrigo Theory 15, Joshua Grasso 16, Rodrigo Theory. Is anyone still out there on track that's close? Tony Casado in 18, Kevin Hines in 19, David Schmidt crosses the line in 21, JD Daniel in 21, Jordan Smith in 22, Jeff Lacey in 23, Curtis Jones in 24, Mike Braun by himself there, he goes in 25, Jacob Simmons crosses in 26. He gained a couple positions off the end of that. Andrew Korosecki in 20 is not over. It is not over for this one. He has got James Hansen 2/10 down on him, and that is WCR in the start straight finish. Not going to be an issue there. He's going to probably get across the line in ahead for P27 on James Hansen in 28 there. Luke Patrick also going to be in 29.
Yep.
Flavio Barros takes 30. Evan Gramke has one driver behind him of Luca Filippone, and he's going to not make that spot. And there he is right there in the background for 32nd, 33 for Bob Lindell of Omek. Emery Anderson.
I will go ahead and jump in and let everybody know before everybody heads out post-race. A replay of this entire broadcast will be on our YouTube channel. You can look us up, Broken Wing Racing League. But we will send the video out to all of the three other league owners and get it distributed in case anybody wants to see the replay of this stream.
In-game replay too, if possible.
I will have my guys grab a replay.
Nice. Throw it up then. Yeah, because I think there's maybe a couple things to look at, but yeah, great race, and happy to see such close racing for the most part.
Yeah, and everyone has crossed the line finally, and from the drivers that not have been mentioned, Nathan Sides in 34, Robert Crivelli in 35. Michael Doyen in 36, Luke Patrick in 37, Thomas Sacasio in 38, Devin Adams in 39, Mitch Buenaventura in 40, Ben Grabo in 41, Alex Petrovsky in 42, Zachary Bowman in 43, Chris Krause in 44, Brian Berthume in 45, John Pardo in 46, John Schwartz in 47, Dustin Smith in 48, and two drivers that didn't compete were there as subs. That is everybody on the grid, as you can see, who had a result. I mean, what a fantastic race. Great close racing. I don't know what to say. That was fun. Sean, yeah. Noah?
Yeah, I mean, on behalf of BWRL, I'd like to thank Omek, Cass and West Coast Racing for joining us for this. It's a fun thing that we put on. It I think it brings in a good competition, friendly competition for a lot of the leagues that run similar series. So it's definitely something that we enjoy doing every week 13. during our off week. It's definitely something that we'd like to keep doing in the future. But you know, I'd like to thank the other three leagues for doing this with us for sure.
Yeah, definitely. Really happy to have been here. If you could send me over the just DM me the mailing address for Trey Mistak, because he's obviously getting a trophy for his second place finish, and his contact info, and I'll get that off to the sponsor for his prize. And yeah, we'll go from there. But fantastic job tonight, and thanks for letting me come and hang out in the announcer's booth.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thanks for announcing with us.
Yeah,
Sorry, one more thing. Jason, and then we will get the points scored up. We'll get all of it figured out, along with you know, the safety bonuses. We'll get it all scored up and hopefully distributed out to the respective leagues here tomorrow or the day after, and get kind of like a final points tally here soon.
Yeah, all I wanted to add on top of what you guys were saying is thank you to the OMEC and Cam-Am drivers that came out. I mean, they really showed some great close racing, especially at a WCR, you know, BWRL. Everyone, it was great. You know, four leagues. I want to see this again. You know, really crazy tracks, maybe. I mean, it was fantastic. Not a whole lot of incidents that happened. And, you know, a lot of them that we did see, you know, driver error on their own, you know, going, you know, not really collecting anyone, but fantastic overall. Thank you, Sean and Noah, for joining me. And thank you, everybody that was watching. We really appreciate it. And we do stream a lot of races. GT3 is going to be our championship for season 11 is going to start next Sunday. When you guys want to join us?
Yeah. I mean, thanks everybody again for putting it out. It's a great race. Lots of close competition.
All right, and thank you, everybody, and we're heading off.
All right. Thanks, guys.
Yep. Thanks.